Please remain standing. As Jesus talks of returning to the Father, he promises to send the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, who will teach Jesus' followers and remind them of all that Jesus taught. Even more, those in whom God makes a home will experience a peace that overcomes fear. A reading from John. Jesus answered Judas, not Iscariot, "Those who love me will keep my word, and my Father will love them, and we will come to them and make our home with them. Whoever does not love me does not keep my words, and the word that you hear is not mine, but is from the Father who sent me. I have said these things to you while I am still with you. But the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all that I have said to you. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid. You heard me say to you, I am going away, and I am coming to you. If you loved me, you would rejoice that I am going to the Father, because the Father is greater than I. And now I have told you this before it occurs, so that when it does occur, you may believe." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Seated for the message.
Please be seated. Good morning.
Good morning.
You might recognize me, but can't quite place me. I'm Tina Royer, a member at Salem Lutheran Church. I enjoy reading scripture, serving communion, and ushering, and can usually be seen and heard at the early service. For the past year, I have attended a Bible study fellowship where we have studied the book of Revelations. Hoo-hoo. It's been pretty intense and a huge learning curve for me. Next year, we will study the book of John. So instead of being a day late and a dollar short to offer any kind of in-depth wisdom about our gospel today, I'm a day early and still a dollar short. So when Pastor Glenn asked me to fill in with the morning message, so those of our, wanted to listen to me. I hope he's okay. Okay. He asked me to fill in with the morning message so those of our congregation could attend the Synod Conference this weekend. I was rather hesitant and very surprised. I have spoken to many groups, but this is my first time offering a faith-based message, and the jury is out on whether or not it is my last. I have newfound respect for Pastor Glenn and all ministers for their ability to offer a new sermon every week, a sermon that is centered around the week's gospel or scriptures and world events that challenges us to listen, to think, to reflect, to learn, and to put this knowledge and our faith into action. This is no small feat, but God and proper schooling gives Pastor Glenn and others the ability to wisely use their time, talents, knowledge, and faith to adequately represent God in their words to their congregations. This morning, I shall do my best to offer you some of the same. As Jesus talked to the disciples about his leaving them, This morning's gospel speaks of God sending the advocate, or the Holy Spirit, in Jesus' name and physical presence to be with them. Needless to say, they were confused and afraid about this new power and how it would affect them. It brought a different perspective to their lives, one that lacked understanding of the Trinity and the role of the Holy Spirit in it. But Jesus encouraged and assisted his disciples to know that the Holy Spirit would be there for them after he went to be with his Father, the Lord God. And in so believing, they would lose their fear and find peace. In John verse 27, Jesus proclaims, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid." A theologian added further explanation of Jesus' proclamation by stating, "Safety consists not in the absence of danger, but in the presence of God. Peace consists in the presence of God." In yet other words, the peace that Jesus gives is not the absence of suffering, trouble, or pain, but is rather the confidence, blessing, and comfort that he is there with you always. Peace is a precious jewel. It was a gift that he bestowed upon his disciples and remains a precious jewel for us today. Jesus talked to the disciples about the Holy Spirit in a rational way. But over the centuries, we have always been learning and interpreting more of God's message than what was known to the citizens of ancient times and to Christ's disciples. Today, we view him from a different perspective than how he is portrayed in the Old Testament. In Genesis 1, we read about God as the invisible Almighty One who created man in his own image. God was omnipotent. He remains omnipotent, but in the New Testament, Jesus introduces the integration of the Holy Spirit and the Trinity. The Trinity is described in any number of ways in order to lend individuals a clearer picture of what is often regarded as perplexing to understand. The books of Thessalonians and Hebrews describe the human body as a trichotomy, body, soul, and spirit. At this point, before I got myself in over my head in trying to describe something that is still difficult for me to understand, I asked Pastor Glenn to help me present an analogy to us so that we might better understand how the same triune or Trinity deepens our relationship with God. He made the comparison of the common element of water in its three modes of existence. It is a liquid, water, it is a vapor, steam, and it is a solid, ice. In the analogy, God is the center element and is made present through himself, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit. A nice clear picture appears in our mind's eye, but it still falls short of the mystical and mysterious that is the Holy Trinity. In the Trinity, God is seen as the wise, loving, all-knowing Father who has the power to judge faith, love, and obedience to him. Jesus, God's Son, is our friend and trustworthy comrade who brings us the Word of God and offers us peace through the Holy Spirit, which is sent in the name of Jesus and through Jesus to be present with us today. We have the most intimate relationship with the Holy Spirit who dwells in us through Jesus. The Holy Spirit gives us the power to walk in God's way and to experience confidence and peace. We experience it in an emotional way that when it happens can oftentimes be overwhelming. I would like to share my story of experiencing how the Holy Spirit came to me, filling me with God's peace and love that now dwells within me. As I do so, I will share three miracles I experienced to illustrate that miracles do happen in our lives. We just have to be open to experiencing them. In January of 2011, I missed an entire week of work due to illness. I thought it was flu, or what we like to call the gunk. Whatever it was really bad because I hadn't missed work in years for being sick. At 2:30 that Tuesday morning, I woke up screaming and crying because of unbearable pain in my right calf. Tears were streaming down my face as I massaged my leg to help ease the pain. My leg had become at least 4 or 5 sizes larger than it usually is. The next morning, I called to make a doctor's appointment and got in. I drove myself to the doctor's office, but couldn't walk because I was unable to put any weight on my affected leg. I pretty much crawled alongside the building until I got inside when they gave me a wheelchair. The doctor ordered an ultrasound. Oh, and by the way, they said, oh, do you need a wheelchair? Yeah. The doctor ordered an ultrasound thinking I might have blood clots. When that came back clear, he told me to take it easy and suggested several things to do to ease the pain and the swelling of my leg. It didn't get much better, and by Sunday, the area affected was still swollen and had turned almost black. On Monday, I returned to work, but by 9 a.m., I couldn't take it anymore and went back to the clinic. Then I saw a nurse practitioner who immediately ordered a blood test. When she returned with the results, her face was ashen and she had to sit down to tell me the news. She told me my white blood cell count was at 274,000, and the normal count in our body is anywhere around 11,000 or a little less. I didn't know what that meant at the moment, but the nurse practitioner then indicated that nothing could be done at the clinic and called the emergency room at St. Mary's Hospital in Duluth to get the help I needed there. She suggested I pack a bag since I might be in for a night or two and gave me strict instructions that I could not drive myself there. I went back to work to get some things to work on and asked my assistant if she would drive me to Duluth. I told my staff that I would be gone for a couple of days at the hospital in Duluth and wished everyone well. At the time, little did I know that I would never step foot in my offices again. After a quick stop at home, we headed to Duluth. I had a quick stay in the ER. I was whisked up to a private room and didn't have to wait long to get a visit from not one, but two specialists. One was an oncologist and the other a hematologist, a cancer and a blood doctor. They were caring, compassionate physicians, and they got right to the point. They told me I had cancer, most likely leukemia, and it looked severe enough to be beyond their ability to care for me at St. Mary's. By that time, it was 8 o'clock Monday night. My assistant was still with me, as well as several friends. My husband, Rad, was on his way from Pequot Lakes, where he taught high school chemistry and physics. He arrived shortly after I was given the news. Everyone in the room was crying and offering their get-well wishes to me. But for some reason, I was not crying. Instead, I was busy consoling everyone in the room. Perhaps I was in shock, but for some reason, I believed right from the beginning that I would be okay. The doctors didn't want to waste any time in getting me to the Mayo Clinic in Rochester, but my traveling was delayed until my insurance was in place. And I was good to go. The next afternoon, I was transported by ambulance to Mayo Methodist Hospital, which became my home for the next 43 days. It also served as my go-to place for the rest of 2011. By the way, Rad never left my side and slept in my hospital room all 43 of those nights. My first appointment with a physician occurred after I had gone through a process that seemed similar to kidney dialysis, and it took out the 274,000 cancerous white blood cells. I was told that I made it through the first big step because not everyone lives through the process. And then after I gave about just short of 20 vials of blood, I was convinced I didn't have any blood left in my body. Finally, when the doctor saw me, he pulled no punches and told me that if I hadn't sought help for my illness, I would have had about 6 to 8 weeks to live. I had a form of leukemia that was one of the hardest to treat. So he added that he couldn't guarantee I would make it beyond the 6 to 8 weeks, but he would work hard to make a difference. He then laid out Plan A, Plan B, Plan C, and asked me if I had any questions or concerns about any of them. I told him to go with Plan A, and when all is said and done, I will hopefully be cancer-free. As I said that, once again, I felt a sense of peace and felt a wave of calm wash over me. The Holy Spirit was with me, calming me, but I wasn't fully aware of that then. A major piece of the treatment included a stem cell transplant that would be from a donor other than myself. Both my brother and sister were tested. Miracle number one in my journey, my brother Charlie was a perfect match. I still get goosebumps, and he's my hero. I felt confident about what was to come, but little did I know just how much suffering and fear I would experience as I went through my treatment. I had full body radiation and a chemo drug that was so strong, it seemed that the cure was worse than the disease. My transplant took place on April 14th. All went well, and the entire procedure took less than 45 minutes. I was now going to live with my brother's blood cells. I felt like I was reborn, and praise the Lord. Once I was done with my primary treatment, I was given less toxic drugs and after a while started to feel better. But that feeling didn't last. There were still near impossible hills and valleys to face. It was during these episodes that my faith was shaken. It was especially so when in July 2011, my doctor informed Rad and me that the transplant had failed, that my white blood cells were taking over my body again. I was devastated. I felt defeated in life and in faith. What to do now? It was then my doctor offered a potential solution, a procedure that is similar to the transplant I had, using leftover cells that my brother had produced and Mayo had frozen for emergency use. In August 2011, once again, I got a new lease in life. You can imagine how much I apologized to the Lord and said, oh, I'll go to church every Sunday. Oh, well. But my trials and tribulations were not going away. Hospital stays became more frequent and longer. I was on a downhill course that had me experiencing instances where I hallucinated and believed I was in hell, which devastated my family and friends and created an atmosphere of helplessness and at times hopelessness. But I finally saw myself stepping into heaven through that bright light to visit my deceased mom and dad. It was wonderful to be with them. They were happy and healthy and were doing good deeds in heaven. But I heard a whispering in my ear telling me that I had to go because it wasn't my time yet. God still had plans for me on earth. Once again, I began to feel the power of God's love and healing. It was then I knew the Holy Spirit actually dwelled in me and in my heart. I slowly opened my eyes and saw my daughter Erica sitting in her chair with a gentle smile on her face and tears in her eyes. She then said to me, thanks for coming back, Mom. You were talking to your mom and dad, and I tried to tell you it's too early to do that. I'm so glad you're here. You were walking a tightrope, and we didn't know if you would fall off or not. I did some paraphrasing just now, but this is what I remember. This was miracle number two. A few months later, I was sitting in a restaurant having breakfast with family members when I was approached by a person from a nearby table who I had noticed kept uncomfortably looking away, or looking my way. She finally came over to me to tell me that she had noticed a glow, an aura around me that she believed was the Holy Spirit. She said that she had no clue what I was experiencing in life. She only knew that I was going to be fine. What a spine-tingling experience that was, to have a stranger notice the aura of the Holy Spirit. And I call that my miracle number three. Once again, it was time to put my body in gear and work on healing. I had never given up. I always pushed myself to work at healing, but there's a huge difference between simply going through the motions and that of healing with the Holy Spirit in you. I am still on that road. It has not been smooth or easy. There are countless physical, mental, and emotional barriers and challenges that are a daily part of my life. But my faith carries me through all that I face, and I know the Holy Spirit is a gift from God that gives me the power to walk in the Lord God's way, to walk in Jesus' footsteps, which brings me peace and a sense of gratitude for the countless blessings I receive every day. Through it all, I have never, ever asked why. Why me, Lord? It's a pointless question to ask that has no answers. What I do ask is, how can I serve you, Lord? How do I live a purpose-filled life that honors you? To start, I have chosen to live a life of gratitude, and I work to feel the Holy Spirit and God's grace throughout my day. I rejoice when I experience the peace that Jesus gives me. I believe you don't have to have the life-changing situation that I did to feel the presence of the Holy Spirit. I sincerely hope you never experience a life-threatening illness. The gospel says to open yourself to love God and let the Holy Spirit in. Once you let the Holy Spirit in, you will feel God's grace, His love, and His peace all around you. I wish and pray for God's grace and love to all of you. Amen.